Jeffrey Williams, a retired U.S. Army officer and NASA astronaut. He is a veteran of four space flights and served as the commander of the Nemo 3 mission aboard the Aquarius Underwater Laboratory. Jeffrey spent 534 days in space and took there more than 450,000 pictures. He is a devoted Christian and a reputable speaker at various conferences around the world.
How would you respond to Yuri Gagarin's famous quote? He said, "I have been to space and haven't seen God there." How would you respond to that?
Well, one, I would give Yuri a little bit of benefit of the doubt. That's the quote that's very popular to attribute to him. But I remember doing some reading on it. The actual quote was a little bit longer, had a little bit more content.
Yeah.
A little bit softer in how it would be received. I can believe that he went there, he looked around, he didn't see God directly. None of us really do, right? We see evidence of the God. So I think it was actually maybe Khrushchev that took that segment of his quote out of context and made it basically a banner for atheism, for communism.
Oh, yeah, it was part of the propaganda, but yeah, nevertheless, yeah. There is this quote that I think if it would be addressed by a person, a professing Christian astronaut like you, it would be beneficial for all other listeners who are used to hearing this quote as part of this. So what would you say to that?
Well, look at the evidence. How do you explain the existence of all things? How do you explain the origin of what we see? How do you explain the intelligence and design that we see in all things? I mean, you just the evolution, supposed theory of evolution of life, with the technology that we have nowadays with microscopes and other technology, and we see down to the cellular level. A cell is a fascinating machine that has all kinds of logical processes that go on with it that are chemically balanced, that have dynamics. There's actually little deliveries of supplies inside a cell based on the demand and the need of the life of the cell. And then you multiply that into the millions or billions of cells in the body of a human being, and you look at all of the networks of communication among cells, different types of cells. You can have the different systems like the muscle system, the bone system, the circulatory system, the respiratory system. It all works together. So you have this concept that's referred to as irreducible complexity in all of those levels that I just gave a glimpse into, and there's many, many more, that if you take one part away, the whole system fails.
Mm-hmm.
So it's illogical. It makes no sense that something evolved piece by piece over millions of years into this complexity, this complex organism that can't be reduced in reverse. So therefore, that's one of the logical explanations to show that it could not evolve into that.
Mm-hmm.
When you study life and you study generations of life and you see genetic change, all you ever see is you either from one generation to another, you break even or you devolve. God's creation, because of the fall, is decaying away.
Mm-hmm.
So devolution, de-evolution mm-hmm. is actually taking place, not evolution.
You are a very rational person, and you were an unbeliever for a long time. How did it happen that you became a Christian?
Well, it was through circumstances of life, and ultimately, of course, I did not decide to become a Christian. God reached out and changed my heart and changed the inclination of my heart. To recognize my need and to have that need satisfied in Him, in Jesus Christ, and the work on the cross.
Mm-hmm. But how did it happen? If you could share in a few words.
Well, I was about 29 years old. My wife and I had been married for 7 years, and as is not uncommon in marriages, especially young marriages, maybe we took some things for granted, and circumstances led to difficulties in our marriage, which led to a crisis in our marriage. Through that crisis, God used the circumstances in His providential care to first bring my wife to faith.
Mm-hmm.
And I questioned that, but it drove me to study. As you said, I am very rational, so I wanted to understand what this faith was. I wasn't just going to join her blindly. So I spent actually several months studying the Bible every night, primarily the Gospel of John and the letter to the Romans. And after several months, I was convicted of the truth. I understood the gospel very clearly, and I committed myself to Christ.
Did you try to rationally understand the gospel? Did you struggle with understanding, with rationale, gospel?
I think I had, the entire time looking back, I had a confidence in the Bible. I just wanted to know what was in it. I wanted to understand it. I didn't want to, say, prematurely jump on a bandwagon just because others were of the faith. I wanted to be able to articulate what ultimately I said I believed in. So it was less of a rational pursuit, more of a just a pursuit to want to understand. And by the grace of God, He brought that understanding to me in the acceptance of the gospel that we find in the work of Christ.
But you did believe in God before that, or were you an atheist?
No, I would say I believed in God. I was just, you can use the word agnostic or something like that. I was raised with my parents saying we were Christians, although we did not participate in a church. So we were more cultural Christians. We identified ourselves culturally as a Christian. And I think I carried that with me, although I was too busy in life to spend much time on it. So I certainly I was not a believer because I was living on my own. Mm-hmm. But again, through those circumstances, God taught me my need and reached out and saved me. And by the way, it was my wife and I, so we were both saved in that period of a few months. And after that point, we dedicated ourselves to live for Christ, to serve Him, rebuild our marriage based on what the Bible teaches, rebuild the philosophy of life, rebuild the way we raised our children. And I approached my work, and we immediately went on the search for a church, a body of Christ to join. In fact, we're still in the church that we committed to 32 years ago.
Wow. What a grace of God. Wow. Is it difficult to be a Christian astronaut? Are there unique challenges for an astronaut who is also a professing Christian?
I would say no. By the grace of God, it has not been difficult for me. It's never been an issue in my work, certainly not in space. I think everybody is aware of my faith. But there are other American astronauts that are strong believers as well. So it's not uncommon among us, at least in America. What I have found is, at least in a passive way, but certainly also to some extent an active way, just to respect and perhaps trust and confidence in me as a teammate, if you will, as a crewmate.
Have you ever convinced someone that there is a God? Is it easier to convince someone to believe in God using your experience and knowledge of space?
I don't know if, I wouldn't say it's easy to convince somebody, and ultimately it's not up to us, right? We, as believers, we're just called to give testimony to Christ, give testimony to the Word of God, give testimony to the authority that we regard in the Word of God. And ultimately, it's the grace of God that works in people's hearts. But I think that we can be an instrument to stimulate, to maybe put people off guard that have a set of assumptions or presuppositions that we can show how they fail logically, how they fail in coherence, and bring somebody to question what they assume, what they presuppose. And maybe that will be a path to eventually, by the grace of God, coming to faith. So certainly we can be a witness.
So you are, and if I'm wrong, correct me, you are a test pilot that have tested more than 50 different types of planes, an astronaut that has spent 534 days in space, and a manager of one of NASA departments. That's a success by the world's measure. Very impressive resume. And all of a sudden, you decide to go to seminary. Why? What is this move? Is this something to do during retirement years, or is it something else, something bigger?
Well, I don't know. I've been for 32 years now or more, I've been studying the scripture. So as soon as I came to faith, I was motivated to continue to grow and know in the Word of God. Shortly after coming to faith, we discovered the Grace to You program, the ministry of John MacArthur, and it became our habit to every night have the boys in bed by 8:30 or so. So the 9 o'clock Grace to You program we could listen to, and I had an open Bible and a notepad and a pen, and I was always taking notes. So John, through that ministry, really taught me the Bible over the next 10, 15 years. During that time, I was asked and accepted the request to start teaching in my church, adults, and that has only grown over the years. When I got the opportunity to join NASA as an astronaut 24 years ago, I continued to teach, but then I got requests often to tie that technical aspect of my life into the biblical worldview. Mm-hmm. So I started very early working to endeavor to articulate that, trying to merge the two. Of course, you get questions all the time about the supposed conflict between science and scripture. And mm-hmm. So anyway, it's that then led to the time where I knew I wasn't going to fly in space anymore. And a window of opportunity opened up where I realized, yeah, I could have this opportunity to go through a formal seminary training program at the Master's Seminary. And it all worked out, and I applied and was accepted, and now I'm in my final year.
So seminary is kind of like a logical conclusion to everything that you've been doing already before that.
Yeah, I think so. It's where I was doing it on my own, more of a self-study. Now it's more of a formal program.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What influenced the most your personal development as a Christian? What, or maybe it's a human being or whom?
Oh, by far, it's the ministry of John MacArthur through Grace to You. I had listened to him for 12 years or a little more before having the opportunity to meet him. In fact, on my first flight to space in 2000, as a gift back to John and the ministry in gratitude for what they have been doing and had personally done for me, I offered to fly something for them in the space shuttle, and it ended up we flew a CD, which was very easy to fly, of the MacArthur Study Bible. So I flew that to space for that 10-day flight, and then had the opportunity to return it to the ministry. And that's when that began our personal relationship. And John and I have crossed paths many times in ministry, to include in Moscow. At the release of the MacArthur Study Bible, I was there training just outside of Moscow, and we were able to get together there. For several years now, I've served on the board of directors at Grace to You. So that has been a major component of not only my growth in Christ, but also the worldwide ministry opportunities.
I'll ask a question that concerned me for a very long time. Why do we, the human race, need to study the space? What's the point of spending billions of dollars for this project, for the research, for studying the space? If we could probably just live on Earth and be just fine without knowing what's going on.
I get that question a lot. That's a very common question. It's a philosophical question. So I usually answer it with a philosophical answer.
Right.
human beings, mankind, was created with the image of God, in the image of God, in the likeness of Him. And that is unique to humans. That's what brings our personality. But and also in the creation account, as we know in Genesis 1, God gave the commission to mankind to subdue the earth. And He has uniquely and amazingly provisioned His creation for exploration, for discovery, for utilization, for with the resources that can be developed and utilized. If you look at it that way, that's the basic explanation for all of history of human civilization in terms of technology development, economics, mm-hmm. commerce, engineering, mm-hmm. all of that. Well, that I believe that basic drive is in human nature, bearing the image of God. Even in the state of the fall, we still bear the image of God. Mm-hmm. Of course, that brings lots of challenges and toil and hard work and failure because of the fall mm-hmm. in that endeavor, but still that's in our nature. So we, by nature, have this drive to ask the big questions of life. Why and what and how and where? And that manifests itself in our inherent curiosity to explore, to see what's there, and then figure out how to use it, and then we use it. So space exploration is just one chapter of current history of human exploration. Now, of course, there are many motives for it. There are many stated motives for it. One of the common ones is trying to search for evidence or clues that can explain the origin of all things. Mm-hmm.
What people are looking for?
Well, I think many non-believers will answer the question that way, the source of life, for really over a century. It's been a fantasy of humanity to go to Mars. You see Mars, it's a planet. Although it's far away, it's not that far away. We know that it is possible technologically to develop the capability and send a crew there. We've sent many spacecraft there, unmanned spacecraft already. We've got rovers on the surface. So we understand what it would take to do that. It just, it's a question of the political will to do it. Now the philosophical question behind that is trying to maybe support the theory that we came to be by chance over time. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So the theories of evolution.
All right, but let me ask you a more rational question. Mm-hmm. Why would governments spend millions and millions of dollars on something that's just a philosophical issue?
Sure.
Instead of spending those billions of dollars on solving a lot of problems in the world, like poverty and you know, all different financial issues in their own countries.
Sure. Well, that's a rational question.
Right.
I was answering it philosophically. If you want to answer it rationally, you rationalize it as it's a logical investment to make for the future. We enjoy lots of luxuries of life nowadays that is a result of research and development that occurred over years and years and years, every generation building on the work of previous generations, standing on the shoulders of previous generations in that work. If you study the history of science, that is how you can describe it, and that has produced benefits for all of humanity. The common question of why don't we just fix the problems on Earth, you know, the poor, the water and food, the basic provisions of life, those challenges will always be there no matter what the investments are made. I think in the long term, technology development and bringing that technology to those parts of the world, to those areas, ultimately bring prosperity potentially to that area. Prosperity it doesn't come just by throwing money at a problem. Prosperity has to be self-generated. People have to learn personal responsibility to do the work prosper. So it's a very complicated question with a very complicated answer. The answer is not just, hey, cancel this program to save the money and throw the money at the issues of whatever problem you want to pick.
What are some of the biggest researches that were done in space that resulted in something productive or some huge technological advances?
That's a big, broad question.
Name a few.
Well, I've done hundreds of experiments on the space station, and really as the crew in the space station, for example, we're just lab technicians, so we get an assignment to execute this experiment. We execute it, and we send the data to the ground, and then all the specialists for that experiment, they analyze it and they build it. And sometimes it can take years to get to an answer or answers in that particular research area. But to give you some examples, I'll give you one big family example. That is the study of the human body. We're motivated, of course, from a practical point of view to study the effects of the space environment on the human body, particularly the adverse effects, so that we can develop countermeasures for those effects and to be prepared to go further into space, to go back to the moon on a more semi-permanent basis, eventually to go on to Mars. So the space station is a laboratory to execute those kinds of experiments. And so we're all guinea pigs in that regard. But that research doesn't just get applied to the environment of living and working in space. It also, in many cases, applies to the research that's going on a ground for application in the medical field on the Earth. So it's just another source of data to inform that research than to develop benefits for Earth.
All right. Fair enough. Makes sense. Why did you personally decide to become an astronaut? Was it a thought-out decision, or is it just sort of happened?
Well, I grew up on a small dairy farm in northern Wisconsin, and at that time, as a kid, then I never realized that I might have the possibility to do something like that. In the summers, I helped my grandfather build homes, and I thought, well, I'm going to be one of those few people from my hometown to go to the university, to go to college. My father was a school teacher also. He was an inspiration to me in that regard. And I thought at that time, well, with my experience of building homes, I had an interest in being a civil engineer. But I also grew in having an interest in the military. And particularly the Army, and I got introduced to the fact that West Point, the military academy, exists through the work of my father. He had done some work as a guidance counselor, and the Army had actually sent him to West Point and the other academies to tour them so that he could be more effective in that regard as a guidance counselor for students. Mm-hmm. So I learned about the academy. I decided, well, I want to go do that. So I applied and was accepted. And after I arrived there, then I discovered that the Army just doesn't do things on the ground with tanks and guns and whatnot. They also have aircraft, mostly helicopters. And during basic training there, my first summer, I was exposed to, we were out on a field exercise. I got picked up. We all got picked up by helicopters. And I thought, wow, this is cool. I want to do this. So I decided at that point that in the Army, once I graduated, I wanted to go to flight school.
How big is the competition to get into the space program?
Now that I've been in the program and look back, I ask myself the question, why did they pick me when there were so many? It's huge, yeah. I recall the year I was selected, there were maybe 6,000 applicants. And that was a big class. I was in a class of 35, but 35 out of 6,000. 3 years ago, we ran a selection, the most recent selection, and we had 18,000 applicants, and we picked 12.
So out of 18,000, 12 get picked, and you were one of those 12.
For my class, it was one of 35.
Mm-hmm. Out of 6,000.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, that's huge. Okay, so what did you feel when you first saw the Earth from space?
Oh, it was amazing. I had talked to folks that had been there before in preparation for it, but it was absolutely incredible to get to space. Of course, you're focused on the ascent and the rocket, in my case, the space shuttle. But the first time you get the view out the window and see the globe and see how fast we're traveling over the surface of the Earth, it was absolutely incredible. And even after spending, as you said earlier, 534 days in space over four flights, I never got tired of seeing the Earth. So I was taking every moment, even up to the last day, to get in the window and to try to, through photography, capture the uniqueness of the vantage point from in that moment, in that place.
What is this feeling? Is it something compared to, I remember when I first saw the Grand Canyon,
mm-hmm.
and I felt like, oh, and I wanted to cry, and you couldn't really describe this feeling. Is it something like this, or it's
yes,
even greater?
It's greater, but when I often use the illustration of standing on the rim of the Grand Canyon and viewing it as something that approaches the feeling and the response that you have when you look out the window and see the globe.
Wow. Wow. Was it ever scary? Did you have a moment when you thought, okay, this is it, we're not going to make it?
I don't think I ever have that moment, and we don't really think that way. When an emergency comes up or some unexpected situation, you're just trained and you... I wouldn't say naturally, but it's part disposition, part training and preparation, part actually being in the experience. You just do what you need to do, and you do it almost automatically. And you do it without a lot of emotional response. You just do it. And then you get through the time, and then maybe look back and say, wow, that was a close one, or I'm glad that worked out well. But in the middle of the response, you don't have those kinds of emotions going. I think if you did, maybe you answered the wrong call. Maybe you're in the wrong place.
Okay. So you guys are fearless. Yeah. What was the single most exciting experience in space? Can you name one?
It's really difficult to name one, but if you force me to put the number one experience on the list, it would be doing a spacewalk.
Wow.
It's one thing to be there and to look out the window and see everything you can see. It's quite another thing to get into a spacesuit and then start climbing hand over hand outside the space station and see the size and the scale of the space station itself, that we put this thing together over many years. It's bigger than a football field, and it's traveling 25,000 kilometers per hour, orbiting the Earth every 90 minutes. And then behind that, you see the entire globe of the Earth. And you recognize continents, of course, and shorelines and, you know, the different shapes that we've all studied in school or observing on a globe. It looks just like that.
Wow. How long is the spacewalk?
Typically, a spacewalk is planned for about 6.5 hours. So they average from 6 to 7 hours or so.
So you actually spent 6 hours in open space?
Yeah, five different times.
Oh, wow. Wow. So in one interview, you once said that you take credit for 450,000 pictures. How is it possible to take that many?
Well, when you take all the opportunities that you have, free moments here and there, and you're motivated to take the pictures, I guess you can get them. I remember there were many days where I would take more than 1,000 pictures, especially on a weekend when I had a little bit more free time. When the orbits over the Earth were particularly interesting to me, you know, and I had specific areas of the Earth that I really wanted to capture or were just of interest because of the weather patterns or the particular terrain or season or whatnot. So my motivation was to recognizing that there's so few folks that get the opportunity to actually go experience that. There's a responsibility that we have to share the experience. Virtually everybody wants to know about space. Right. What was it like? You know, can you describe it for me? I get those questions all the time. Well, I believe that a still photograph that captures a moment from that vantage point is an excellent way to vicariously bring somebody else to that vantage point to see the view. And then, of course, you can add description to the photograph. So that was my primary motivation, was to build a catalog of material that would enable me to vicariously bring people to the experience and particularly view the Earth from that vantage point.
But 450,000, wow. So, do you have your favorite picture? What do you consider your best picture that you've taken from space?
Oh, I don't know if I have a favorite. There are many pictures that are of favorite. I see you have the book here. When I completed the manuscript of this book, I submitted it to the publisher along with, as I recall, about 350 of what I thought were some of the best pictures across the spectrum of subject matter.
Can you find the best one and we can show it?
Well, I mean, the cover picture is pretty incredible. You see up here an element of the space station, so that gives you a clue on where it's from. It's just a little structure that's sticking out from the space station. But to see the grandeur of the Earth and the beautiful colors of the blues and the weather systems, so that's kind of an overarching
How much picture. Photoshop is in that?
Oh, virtually none.
No?
It might have been just cleaned up. You know, you can have a haze. It's fairly true.
So there's a myth that most of the space pictures are photoshopped. Is that a myth?
No, it's a myth. Now, nowadays in social media, some folks will post on Twitter and whatnot, and they do the
filters.
The post-processing, a lot of times software will automatically kind of, what do you call it, just exaggerates the colors, exaggerates the contrast. So that's a little bit about what you're talking about. I certainly wanted to clean up the photograph in terms of the haze. Mm-hmm. And so you bring out the contrast a little bit more in doing that, I think. But this is what it looks like with the naked eye.
Wow, amazing. So you once said that many astronauts, or maybe most astronauts, have some medical training for emergencies in space. You even mentioned that you visited operating rooms as part of your training. Have you ever had to put your medical training in practice?
Thankfully, I never had a situation where I had to do much serious in response. In my experience, everything was relatively minor, maybe a foreign object in the eye or an abrasion or small cut or something like that. So thankfully, I didn't experience anything serious. But you're right, part of our training is medical training. So I've spent, as you said, several shifts in the operating room, intubating patients. They never knew who did it, perhaps, but we do that training in a teaching hospital in downtown Houston. So we're under very good supervision, if you will. It's a very great experience. I've spent many shifts in the trauma center as well, where you never know what you're going to get, but they're very good about giving us hands-on experience to respond to trauma. And of course, the reason for that is it's very practical. When you're off the planet for 6 months and there's no easy access to it, you know, you can't call the plumber, you can't call the electrician, you can't call 911. So we have to be able to deal with everything that comes up, whether we're repairing equipment or responding to a medical condition.
Do you know historically what was the most serious medical emergency in space that ever happened?
For the most part, everything's been relatively minor. We, you know, because of privacy issues, we don't talk
about
specific cases, especially if it can be tied to an individual. But we've had some things that we've had to work through. We have a staff of medical doctors and other medical technicians on the ground as well that work for NASA and Mission Control. Of course, has experts on all the systems of the space station, as well as a flight surgeon who's typically on duty And they would immediately help us, and they do help us when we have some kind of situation on board to support us. And they do a lot of the analysis. If we have to plan for some kind of treatment, they're the ones that prescribe the treatment and then look over our shoulders, so to speak, vicariously too.
Different topic. You are acquainted with multiple Christian leaders of the day, and you are well informed of what is going on in the Christian world today. What are you happy about, and what are you concerned about regarding the conditions of Christians in the United States today?
Oh, very interesting question. Obviously, there's lots of things that have not, and it's not just contemporary. It's been going on for decades, really. There have been trends for decades in the secularization of our society, in the undermining of the fundamental presuppositions of the founding of our country, religious liberty, rule of law, recognizing that power needs to be distributed because sinful man will abuse power. That's the brilliance, I think, of the founding of America, the uniqueness of it. Of course, ever since then, and particularly in the last 150 years, and in accelerating in recent decades, has been the movement of secularization to undermine the influence of Christianity in American culture. And we know that most of us are aware of all the list of things of specifics. And now in particular, this year, 2020, with it seems to be accelerating more than ever. It doesn't impact significantly my confidence that the church will stand. In fact, history has shown that when the church is persecuted, it is refined, it is actually strengthened, it thrives, it grows under persecution. That doesn't mean that any of us should welcome persecution, but we should be able to accept it with faith and confidence that that we are all working our way through life in the providence of God, and He has a purpose that transcends all of that.
Do you think there will be a persecution soon?
Persecution?
Yeah.
Well, I think it already exists. It certainly exists if you or I as a Christian become more public and can become a target, basically to be exploited by those who want to undermine the church. Most of our activities, we don't experience direct persecution because we haven't been seen or found to be as a target to be exploited by those that would do that. But we certainly see it in current events. We see it in policy making. Thankfully, we have some in the government that even with, well, maybe because of the acceleration of that persecution against the church, they are speaking up in a political venue, bringing the Christian faith back into the public square so at least it can be discussed. And I think that's good. It will more and more force people, that the vast majority of the public who sit on the sidelines and don't engage in it, you know, I just want to go about my life. But when they start seeing it a little bit more publicly, one, if somebody can publicly profess their faith and actually stand up against the opposition, even in the political stage, it empowers others, citizens in general, who think alike to actually step up. And it's not that we have to win the war politically, but it fulfills the calling and the duty of being a citizen of the country and taking responsibility for the liberty that we take for granted.
All right.
I'm sorry, I get long-winded.
No, it's an excellent answer and a follow-up question to that. You lived in different parts of America, you've been moving a lot, and you're well acquainted with its way of life. You've been in different states, Republican and Democratic. How did this country change in 50 years?
Well, I guess the most obvious change that has occurred in recent years is related to the growth of media and the popularity of media and the instant information and the exploitation of that by voices and agendas that don't represent even a small minority of the actual population, but they represent the vast majority of what we hear, the media that we receive. If we listen to it, it magnifies those voices, and those voices have a huge influence on public opinion. For example, I've never seen the state of things in America where we are so susceptible to what I would frankly put in the category of propaganda, where we don't have the logical information. We haven't looked at something in depth, but yet we get the soundbite, we get the advertisement, the reclama, and we just accept it. And if we hear it over and over and over again, maybe from this source, and then we hear it from another source, people are, in the words of Paul, kind of blown by the wind. We start to believe it. So it's very difficult to discern the truth. We begin to suspect everything and think we're being lied to all the time. And you can see that. Confidence and trust in the public square eroding, no matter where the voice is coming from. I tell people in the political world, and I don't mind discussing politics, I'm comfortable, I know most people are not comfortable with it, but I tell folks, stop listening to the commentaries, to the news anchors, to the talking heads that even the debate back and forth from one side or another, because they're just parroting the same information over and over again. And start listening directly to the politicians. And you can go find them. You can find them certainly on the internet, or some channels will carry speeches live, you know, more than others. You can go to C-SPAN or other places. But actually, start spending more time listening directly to the voices, no matter which side you're aligned with, and stop listening to the...
Yeah, the problem is not many people are used to analyzing information on their own.
That's right. We've become, and that's been a tendency in our society, to become more and more shallow, less rooted. You've heard the quote, in fact, I think your pastor used it recently, that prosperity is the daughter of these unique conditions that we've existed in, and the daughter eats the mother, right? Prosperity brings things like we take things for granted, and we become more casual, and we lose the sense of responsibility that we each have to maintain this republic that we've enjoyed and was founded, you know, well over 200 years ago.
Historically, the whole subject of space and space missions can be very political. Have you experienced political pressure in connection to your profession?
No, and I don't know if I agree with that premise.
No, okay.
Space flight, certainly the program, to be able to authorize the program can be political. The drive to execute the program can be developed political. And of course, the biggest example of that was the race to the moon.
Right, the whole USSR,
that was even bigger than what I would call political, though. That was geopolitical. It was Cold War days, and it was a competition for maybe on the world stage, national prestige, and whatnot. So you put that in the political category, but the actual execution of the program is pretty much insulated from the politics, at least in my experience. It's a little known fact that even during the moon race, we landed on the moon in July of 1969 the first time and won the race. But even before that, at least 2 years before that, we were sending, it wasn't public, but we were sending some of our senior NASA managers and engineers to Moscow to begin collaboration. And we even had some Soviet space managers.
And they agreed to that?
Everybody was in agreement. Huh. It just wasn't public. So there was a beginning of collaboration even before the moon landing. In the short term, then, that culminated in the Apollo-Soyuz mission in the mid-70s. It was a one mission where an Apollo spacecraft was launched, commanded by Tom Stafford. There was a Soyuz launched shortly after that, and they docked together and had a little time together as a combined crew. That was the first very public cooperation between the Soviet Union and the United States. And of course, we drew on that experience to motivate the political will, if you will, with the fall of the Soviet Union to become partners in what then became the International Space Station. It's interesting, a corollary to that question in nowadays in the space station program, we know, we're very familiar with the political tensions now between Russia and the United States.
Does it affect somehow?
We have been insulated from it, largely. We've been protected from it. Even though there's a political rhetoric going on that's adversarial between countries at that level, between the administrations, they have both chosen, I think consciously, to leave us alone and let us continue in the partnership of the International Space Station. Of course, we also have the Europeans, European Space Agency, the Japanese and the Canadians as partners. But I would say in particular, the partnership between NASA and Russia has been very good and has only improved. And we started working together in 1992 on this program.
Do you think that the tensions could become too strong for continuation of the collaboration?
Well, the tensions potentially could become too strong for the political support to continue the program.
Right.
They could just cancel it, I suppose. We still have to, we would have to go through the challenge of deorbiting the space station. You can't just leave it there because eventually the orbit will decay slowly and eventually it will re-enter the atmosphere if it's not maintained. And we reboost it every now and then to maintain it in its orbit. So that would still have to be dealt with. My prayer, my hope, and what the reason that we continue to fly today, even with those stresses, is because both countries recognize that there's a great positive aspect in this engagement that we have. Even though it's below the political tension, it's below the radar, and below public awareness, it's a positive engagement, and even between enemies, from a diplomatic point of view, if you have a positive engagement that's out of sight even, it's, I think, in the interest of both sides to maintain that engagement.
Mr. Williams, you spent 534 days in space. It was a record for a while. Spending this long in a confined space with people of different cultures, is it difficult? Do you become close to them? Is it kind of does it ever become like a family, or you try to keep it professional? And how do you resolve conflicts in space?
Mm-hmm. Well, we're all motivated to not have conflict in the first place. And we all have a bad day where we're a little bit grumpy, perhaps. We're getting tired. Things are going on at home that maybe put some stress on an individual. But we recognize that. So we'll give somebody a space to work through that, mm-hmm. support them as able. But generally, everybody's motivated to make it work, to have a good crew atmosphere, to take care of each other, to give each other the space we need when we need it, to be an encouragement, to be part of the team. Literally, I remind folks often that our lives depend on each other.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, and we are confined for a long period of time, so everybody knows before they ever go there, they're motivated to make it work. And generally speaking, we select people for the job with the criteria that they're good team players, that they work well together, that there's a humility they bring, and not a potential for arrogance because of the job title or the opportunity. So we have some training, leadership development training, team training that goes on before a mission. In my experience, and I've been in space with, I think it's on the order of 56 or 57 different people from all of those countries that I, among the partnership and many cosmonauts. And we all have a special bond, a special relationship because of what we've experienced together. And I know you, with your Russian-speaking audience of particular interest to that audience, I can say that of all the cosmonauts that I've flown with, I consider them all close friends that we have, again, a special shared experience.
Wow, that's an interesting notion. You mentioned that astronauts have to be humble. Why humility is so important? How arrogant would something be in the way of a space mission?
I think to have a sense of humility and not to think of yourself as important no matter what you're doing, where you are in life. Now that's a struggle for some more than others. In fact, in the world, in some circles, many circles, humility is not considered an attribute.
Right.
It's a weakness. If you're working, though, in stressful environments where you're dependent upon each other, where you're dependent upon the team, working as a team, arrogance is not healthy at all. Humility is healthy. Humility, I think, is a mark of maturity. Arrogance is a mark of pride, personal pride, maybe personal insecurity. So humility in particular is important in particular in our circumstance.
So why wouldn't they take someone who is arrogant? Why wouldn't they choose someone who is arrogant over the one who is humble?
Well, we have a very robust selection process, a lot of criteria, a lot of evaluation, medical, psychological, and all that. But one of the kind of the bottom lines for the selection committee is, would I want to fly in space with that person? And just like all of our experiences on the planet, if we come across somebody that's a little bit arrogant or a lot arrogant, you tend not to want to spend time with that person in any circumstance, certainly not a team endeavor or to work together toward a goal, because it just brings conflict, it brings tensions, it fosters distrust. And we have to trust each other implicitly. We have to take care of each other. We have to serve each other. There's many attributes in spaceflight that are critical on a crew that are biblical, you could say, all of those attributes that we would expect out of somebody that was serving Christ and thereby serving others.
Recently, you have decided to relocate to the state of Washington, and I know that that part of this decision was influenced by the Word of Grace Bible Church. What exactly did you find here that compelled you to move, if it's not a personal
thing? Yeah, I would say in the providence of God over the last several years, 6 or 7 years, it has led to what is in one sense a family decision to move here. We have 4 grandchildren with our older son and his wife. We brought them here on a vacation a little over a year ago. They were not only fascinated with the beautiful country around us here, they were greatly blessed by the body of Christ that you call Word of Grace Bible Church and the dynamic of the body of Christ. I remember one quote of our daughter-in-law after our visit here was, we were sitting around as a family discussing the visit here, and she said, "That's how I always thought church was supposed to be, where people live in communion with one another, not just for an hour or two on Sunday morning, but are edifying each other, building each other up as a body of Christ in all of life, every day." Personally, my history goes back a little bit longer with the years working with your pastor, Alexei, and I met I think we knew of each other. We both knew of each other before we met. I knew of his ministry here in the States, particularly to the Russian-speaking world. He knew of me as an astronaut and a believer. Of course, my experience leading up to that led me to be in Russia for many, many times. I've been there probably 60 times, accumulating more than 6 years of my time there. Particularly in the early 2000s, I spent about half my time there, 5 or 6 month-long trips or 6 week-long trips a year. So I was immersed in the Russian culture there at Star City outside of Moscow, living and working and training there for flights and, of course, flying the flights. We never thought we would leave Houston. We would never leave our grandchildren. So from a personal point of view, after that visit with all of us here, in conversations again as a family, we started sensing that they were thinking, well, what if we moved to Washington? So I finally asked one day when we were together, you guys interested in moving to Washington? And they admitted to it. And I said, well, if you want to move to Washington, I'll retire. We'll move with you. So it was really a family, personal decision from that point of view.
That's huge. And I'm going to ask kind of a broad question. What is ministry to you?
Ministry is life. If you're a believer, everything you do in life is really ministry. Ministry means service. So if you understand the gospel and you respond to the gospel with that understanding according to the Bible, then all of life becomes service, love for God and love for others. And it manifests itself first in the home, you know, in marriage, with children, with extended family, with close friends, in the work environment, in those relationships that you have outside of all those spheres, or in relationships that you initiate or start, or acquaintances even, that come through the circumstances of providence and day-to-day life. That is ministry.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And what do you consider your personal spiritual calling, if you would, or perhaps a spiritual gift? Do you have one of those?
Well, I think the centerpiece of if my calling in terms of what I've been drawn to do in service to others is teaching the Bible. Either in a home group or in teaching adults on Sunday morning in a Sunday school hour, or for short seasons, there was even a group of Christians in a work environment where we would meet early in the morning once a week and have a little bit of a devotional time, and other settings like that. There's an organization called Officer Christian Fellowship, which is a network of Christians in the U.S. military. And I spent 27 years active in the Army. So later in my career, we were exposed to that. So I also led a group there of military officers and taught the Bible in that setting. So that's probably what I'm, if somebody asked that knows me well, somebody else that knows me well was asked that question, they would probably say teaching the scripture.
Mm-hmm. That's what you do best.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's what I do.
Right. So what are your plans for ministry in the future, or particularly in the Word of Grace Bible Church or elsewhere?
I have no plans per se, but I'm very excited to in anticipation of what the Lord has in store for us here. I think your pastor, Alexei, and I have a common passion in some sense. Obviously, I'm not a pastor, so we don't have that in common. But in terms of the calling that we have from the Lord to serve the church, to proclaim the word, to give testimony to the word of God and the authority of the word of God in the life of the believer, the importance of the local church, we certainly share those convictions. And I think we saw early on the opportunity perhaps to complement each other in ministry. I have a heart for the church in general. But because of my experience, I think I also have a heart for the Russian-speaking church. So we certainly have that in common. So I don't have a plan, but I'm very excited to see what the Lord has in store. And I anticipate there will be some overlap to the Russian-speaking world where I can help in that ministry. But I also can bring, I think, the story of Grace Bible Church and the international ministry to the Russian-speaking world, bring that story, that testimony to the English-speaking world in a unique way. Because if everything is in Russian, only Russian speakers can become aware of what's going on and see the impact.
Yeah, I'm excited. Wow. All right.
In the scope of this year, God brought us closer to each other. Having a shared focus on eternity, we were united by common concerns and common comfort in the promises of our Lord Jesus Christ. During the time of quarantine, we learned to value time spent with friends, and most importantly, we learned to value church. Spending several months confined in our homes, we understood that family relationships are a constant work. Shallow conflicts among churches lost their significance. People realized that first of all, they need to spread compassion, not condemnation. And most precious of all is that many Christians truly acknowledged that God placed them on earth not for personal comfort, but to proclaim the gospel that is needed in the modern world more than ever before. We began to learn how to live for others. Life for others always comes with a cost, and this cost is usually bigger than we thought in the beginning it would be. But amazingly, Christ Himself came to serve and to give His life for the redemption of many. He did not come to just accomplish one or two miracles or preach a little. He came to die. There is no bigger gift than this. Jesus Christ resolved not to just save us from hell, but to give us abundant life, generous, meaningful life. And He called us to follow Him. Every fall, our ministry holds a special fundraising event that helps us to spread the gospel in different languages using multiple platforms. We call it a marathon, because we feel that we are moving toward a common goal with many other people that desire to live for others. Today, we invite you to become a participant of miracles that God performs through preaching of the Word via the Word of Grace International Ministries. We invite you to take part in someone's conversion, help someone find lost faith or fight serious sin, help someone find meaning of life or devote their life for ministry. I know that at this difficult time, not everyone is able to support us financially. If you are in need today, allow us to serve you and bring you comfort from the Word of God. However, if the Lord gives you enough to become a blessing for others, please pray about this opportunity to serve and support the further spreading of the gospel. May the Lord fill you with His true, deep peace and leads you to embrace His plan for you, a life for Him and for others. We do not know what next year will bring, but living for others will never be in vain.
All right. Are there any classified information regarding space that astronauts can't share with the general public?
No, it's a misnomer to think that we have lots of secrets in space, but we really don't. In fact, you can go on the internet on most days, at least work days, during the time the crew is working on space station, and oftentimes see a live video downlink from what's going on. You can go online in the NASA site and see what the crew activities are for the day. We're generally very open, very public. We in designed that way. So space exploration is designed to be public, and we have press conferences all the time. When I was on space station, at least one a week, we would have a press conference, and any questions went, and we were free to answer.
Nice. Now I'm going to ask a question that everybody is interested in. Get ready for this. How do you take a shower in space?
You don't.
What?
No, a shower is not very practical up there. In a weightless environment, the water would fly everywhere. You'd waste a lot of water. It would be difficult to keep up in terms of just cleaning the shower and containing the water. So it is a place that's easily, the conditions, you know, make hygiene very easy. You just use what is the equivalent of a sponge bath.
Okay.
So a washcloth with a little water, and we have rinseless soap, if you will. So if you want to use a soap, you can use that to wipe yourself down, and it's rinseless because it all evaporates, basically. It's a but no, it's very easy to stay clean up there.
Wow. Thank you. All right. What was the single most difficult challenge in your training as an astronaut?
The Russian language. By far.
Really?
Yes. All of the technical things that we do, the volume of everything, the scope of everything we have to train for, of course, that's a challenge. But if you take any particular area, it's not, at least for me, it wasn't particularly challenging. It was a lot of fun and enjoyable. But it's the, I was probably almost 40 years old when I started taking Russian, and it was a requirement for the International Space Station flights. We all learn Russian, and the Russian cosmonauts all learn English, and the other partners need to know both languages as well. But for me, the Russian language was the most mentally fatiguing, you know, painful part of the training. Our lessons are one-on-one, so you can't blend into a class. And they're generally 2 hours long, and I remember just being exhausted mentally in the early years. But then, of course, like anything else, I got to the point where I felt pretty comfortable. I'm still taking Russian lessons. I try to take one lesson a week. And now I just, for years now, they've been just a lot of fun, very enjoyable.
I'm sure that Russian astronauts are learning English, so why do you have to study Russian if everybody speaks English?
We agreed in the beginning of the program that it was operationally practical and in a, if you want to, in a softer sense of the word political, it was the right thing to do to strengthen the partnership. My last three launches were on a Russian Soyuz. The mission control in Moscow, they don't learn English. So when we're working on a Soyuz or working in the Russian segment of the space station with the Moscow mission control, we have to be able to communicate in Russian. But it's just a practical thing.
Do your taste buds stay the same in space?
No, they don't.
No?
Your sensitivity to taste actually deadens a little bit. One of the symptoms that folks typically have in space is more of a head stuffiness. It's not, you don't really have a head cold, but it's a feeling of stuffiness that's equivalent, similar to a head cold. And one of the results of that is a deadening of your sense of taste. So most astronauts and cosmonauts, when they're there, they like to have add spicy things and more flavor sauces and stuff to food to match that sensitivity.
All right. What was the most delicious food you tasted in space?
It depended upon how rare it was. You could have your best, your favorite food. If you had too much of it, you got sick of it. So variety was very important. But I had some great memories of, I had a Canadian crewmate who was returning to Earth midway during my stay. So we overlapped for just 3 months, and then he and the rest of his Soyuz crew returned to Earth. We all have a common food pantry that we all eat the same stuff, but then we're able to take some unique personal requests up. We call that the bonus food. Well, if you don't eat all your bonus food, you can't take it with you. So when he left, I discovered in his leftover bonus food smoked salmon. So that was a special treat to discover and then to enjoy up there. Another example was in 2006 or maybe 2009, flying for the first time, dill pickles, which, you know, both of those examples have stronger flavors.
Right. And, yeah.
So they were very good. And frankly, they were both very good to share with the rest of the crew. So they became the appetizer at the beginning of a dinner meal for you. So it was good for the crew as well.
So, and there's no fridge, so you can't actually have a variety of food that would
that's true.
Need preservation.
All the food has to be preserved at room temperature. It's either dehydrated or wrapped in a container that in package so that it didn't need refrigeration.
All right. Thank you. Do you celebrate birthdays and Christmas in space? And how do you make it special if you do?
Of course, yeah. We've had like Christmas decorations and other holiday decorations that we have stashed on board. That
do you have any pictures of that?
Cumulative.
So we could find it and put it into...
Yeah, I think I remember... The one Christmas I was there, we took pictures. We had the red hats out and other things, and I've got a picture of that. We would celebrate birthdays on board. We would celebrate milestones. My crew surprised me when I passed through my 500th day in space, and we had a little celebration around the table, floating around the dinner table, as we like to say. And that's typically where we celebrated those things was around the dinner table. Just like on Earth, meals became very important socially, if you will, to relax and to talk about the day and talk about families and what was going on Earth and just to have a little bit of downtime.
Birthday presents?
there would be presents passed every now and then. I don't remember a specific example, but... The other treat related to that is every time a supply ship shows up, the ground team would typically pack at the last minute fresh fruits, fresh vegetables. A couple times we got in a container that preserved the temperature ice cream. So that would be a special treat when it arrived. And you opened up the hatch and you could smell the fresh apples, for example. Because you don't get that very often up there.
Wow. So you spent a lot of time in Russia and worked with Russian people in NASA space program for a long time. What do you like the most about Russian culture or Russian people?
I think there are many ways to answer the question, but what first comes to mind is the, and this is dependent upon personal relationships, and I learned early on the importance, particularly in that culture, if you're working together, it was important to invest time and maybe foster a little bit deeper relationship with people than we often have here in America. I mean, even in a neighborhood in America where we live, people tend to keep to themselves. And if you have a friendship, it's more of a surface friendship. I found in the Russian culture, historically, there are reasons to not trust everybody. So you didn't automatically trust people there. The ones you did trust, you had gotten to know very well, and it was over a long period of time, and it was because of an investment of time and effort to develop that trust and relationship. So although you might not have lots of close friendships, the friendships you had were close, and I really appreciate that.
Easier question. What are some of your hobbies apart from work and ministry?
I've always been a woodworker. I enjoy making furniture. I guess that's been the main one. I've been a distance runner up until recent years. Just as you get older, you suffer from things like that. And for me, I needed to stop running because of my back, but I still work out regularly, still very active in exercise. So that's been a hobby. And I haven't had time in recent years, but I used to enjoy fishing more than I've had opportunity in recent years. I grew up in northern Wisconsin on a farm, as I said, and so hunting and fishing was part of life growing up. I'm trying to do a little bit more fishing now and then with the grandchildren. Because we have four grandchildren now, and they enjoy
that. What's your favorite food?
Oh, I don't know. I'm Variation of that question I would get when I was getting ready on the space station, doing an interview and getting ready to return to Earth, say in the next week or two, people would ask me, what is the first thing you want to eat when you get back on Earth? And my answer was always, whatever Anna Marie wants to prepare, because she's a great cook, and she's a gourmet cook, and we hardly ever, when we're home, unless we have to travel somewhere, we hardly ever go out to eat, because she loves to cook, and she's much better at it than even the better restaurants. So that's how I would answer it even now, whatever she wants to prepare.
All right, that works. Do you like Russian food?
Yeah, I do.
Have you tried Holodets? Do you know what that is, Holodets?
I'm sure
like
I have.
That's like a fish jelly.
Oh, yeah. There's also a beef version
of
that, right?
Jelly, yeah.
No, I would say that I haven't really warmed up to that. I will eat it on occasion as a matter of politeness.
But right.
It's like cold soup, right, that has gelled in the refrigerator.
Kind of. Yeah. Looking back on your life, what will you consider your greatest achievement?
I don't know if I think of things that way, but I hope I leave a legacy that demonstrates a faithfulness to the gospel.
And one last question that I ask everyone who takes my interview, if you could address the whole world at once, what would you say to them in 1 minute?
In 1 minute, I would say to pause in the busyness of life, perhaps, and consider the bigger picture of where you are in your time and place on the earth, and what should your priority be? What should your purpose be in life? What kind of legacy do you want to leave for the generations that follow? Because you're not going to take anything with you at the end. And in the big scheme of things, all of us are here in a very short period of time. And that takes you to the fundamental questions of purpose in life. And our purpose is bigger than our life. And our purpose is ultimately realized and fulfilled in the person and work of Jesus Christ, who came to die on the cross on our behalf, suffer the death that we deserve, pay the penalty that we owe, that we can be forgiven of our sins, and have a relationship established with the Creator of the universe for eternity.
Amen. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
I appreciate it very much.
Thank you, Rita.